Hello and welcome to the Snapcast dealing with IR, or infrared spectroscopy. Another one of those topics that fits into the chapter analytical chemistry. Although we're not required to take a look in any detail at the workings of a mass spectrometer, it is worth spending 10 minutes or so taking a look at the background to this instrument. But to begin with, what is essential is getting a grasp of the underlying principles. When we draw a bond, we typically draw it like that. It looks like a stick between the two atoms, in this case two carbons. It would be better, in terms of conveying how a bond actually behaves within a molecule, to represent it like that, as a spring. One might then begin to get the idea of this bond stretching out and then coming back in again. You might also get the idea of the bond possibly bending like so, and then coming back again. These kinds of movements, and there are others, are collectively known as vibrations. Now, the energy associated with these vibrations is very small indeed, considerably smaller than the amount of energy associated with, for example, the jumping of an electron up or down from one energy level to another. You may recall from atomic spectroscopy work the electromagnetic spectrum. And you have, as part of the electromagnetic spectrum, the color part or visible light part of the spectrum. The weakest in terms of energy is red light, and the strongest in terms of visible light would be up here at indigo, or violet perhaps you should call it. Remember the mnemonic Richard of York, gained battle in vain. Now, to the right in this diagram you can see infrared. And look at this wave. You notice that the wavelength shortens as you go from left to right, which is an indication that the energy of the wave is getting higher and higher. So infrared is a part of the electromagnetic spectrum that represents energy that is weaker than the energy of visible light. I would like to move on now and take a look at the two main types of vibration. You see them here, bending and stretching. This here is a mistake, this should say stretching here. Before I do this, I would like to try and explain to you the significance of this term, coupled, which is used in a number of places here. Coupled, it doesn't mean that if you have two bonds that they are doing exactly the same thing, but one might be moving in one direction and one moving in the other. But the way in which they move is coupled together. So for example, in this bending action, which is shown in these models, this is the first stage, second stage, third stage, and then it'll begin to go back to where it was again. In this particular case, the bending is a movement of this bond up in that direction, and this one at the same time is moving up in this direction. And if you were to watch those movements, the fact that they're coupled would be indicated by the fact that they're moving at the same relative speed. And as they get to the top here, perhaps, as is the case in this particular diagram, they get to the top together and then they begin to work their way back down together. What we're observing there is the fact that their movements are coupled. That is one illustration of how a bond is said to be bending. Another type of vibration that's common is stretching. Now, we have here on the left, these three diagrams on the left show stages in what's known as symmetric stretching, and the three on the right show stages in what's known as asymmetric stretching. Without the use of animation here, it is a little bit more difficult to explain this, so let's see if I can. Let's say this is the starting point, and you notice the two bonds are the same length down at the bottom left corner here. Now, in a symmetric stretch, what will happen will be this. In number two here, the bonds are seen to be getting shorter and getting shorter in unison. This is the idea of them being coupled. And then when they get very short, they start to stretch back out again and again in unison. And this is what's known as a symmetric stretch. Over here in diagrams 1, 2, and 3, we have an asymmetric stretch. So for example, this one might start long on the left, and this one starts short. Then as we watch the movement, the movements are coupled, but in opposites. This one here, for example, is appearing to shorten here, and just as it shortens, the shorter one on the right begins to lengthen. So the movement is in unison, although as we observe it, the opposite is happening to one that we're viewing with the other. So as this one here gets shorter, this one's getting longer. And then it goes back to the original position again, as it's this one begins to stretch back to its longer position, while this one begins to contract back to its shorter position. So there you have it, bending and stretching, and the significance of this term, coupled. Here's another diagram that attempts to show stretching. And again, you see the use of the idea of a spring. So stretching, this spring, imagine these two springs here, stretching out, getting longer and thinner, and then coming back to the original position. That's a type of stretching. Bending. Imagine this going up, and at the same time this going up, and then when they get up, starting to come back down again. That's a bending type of vibration. These are all modes of vibrations of bonds within molecules. And then this idea of the symmetric and asymmetric stretching. So symmetric stretching on the left and asymmetric on the right. Here's another one we haven't mentioned, what's referred to as rotational. And the significance here is the two arrows are both going counterclockwise, and then they'll begin to both come back counterclockwise. So that's the difference, I suppose, as you can see there, between the bending and the rotating. In the case of bending, they're going in opposite directions, whereas in rotating they're both going clockwise or both going counterclockwise. No need for us to know about any of these types of vibrations, but these are terms that describe other vibrations: scissoring, rocking, wagging, and twisting. Moving on. The photon, which is a packet of energy. The packet of energy associated with these types of vibrations, I've already said, is small. The photon energies associated with infrared, the part of the spectrum, are not large enough to excite electrons, but they may induce vibrational excitations of covalent bonds. The point that's being made here is this: if you have a particular bond, and for simplicity, let's say when it stretches out and then comes back in again, contracts back into its position, let us imagine, just picking a number, 15, it's an arbitrary number that I've chosen. Let us say that when it stretches, it takes in 15 units of energy, and then when it contracts, it releases 15 units of energy. That seems reasonable. Now, imagine that there are lots of such molecules within a bottle or a container of some kind, and I begin to pass infrared radiation through this bottle or container with millions of these molecules and therefore millions of these bonds. Now, as I begin to tune across the infrared part of the spectrum, presumably starting at relatively long wavelength and low energy, and tuning it rather like you would tune a radio station to try and find the right wavelength for a particular station, as you tune across and you begin to go from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the energy essentially will pass on through and not do anything. But when we come to the energy that coincides exactly with the energy associated with this type of vibration, perhaps it won't surprise you to realize that the molecule you have just, as it were, resonated with exactly the right amount of energy that happens to tune into exactly the energy of that type of vibration. And as I say, perhaps it won't surprise you that the energy, quite a lot of that specific wavelength of energy, suddenly gets absorbed by the sample. And if you have a detector at the other side, so here's the infrared going in, here's your sample, and over here you have a detector. All along, the energy is mostly getting through and the detector's picking that up. No significance. The wavelength of that specific infrared radiation at that point doesn't happen to coincide with any particular vibrational event within the molecule. But when you strike upon 15, or the wavelength that happens to coincide exactly with that photon of energy, the detector will suddenly detect, hold on a second, something went wrong there. Some of the energy there, for some reason, I didn't notice very much energy coming through. And if you imagine this on a graph, if you had some kind of a pen recorder recording how much infrared radiation is getting through, suddenly it'll drop like this and then come back up again, because as you begin to increase the wavelength further, yes, the energy is now greater than the amount of energy associated with that vibration. It's no longer, as it were, resonating. It's no longer in tune with that particular vibration. So the detector notices it's gone back to normal again. Now, if that molecule had more than one type of bond, it might then suddenly do the same thing again and then go back to normal. So we get what are called troughs then on such a graph. Points, instead of peaks, we've got the opposite, troughs. And these troughs then can be used in infrared spectroscopy, like a fingerprint, to show up what particular bonds are present. And if we know the kinds of bonds present, like for example, maybe we've got a C double bond O, maybe we've got an NH bond, maybe we have an aldehyde type link, C double bond OH, maybe we've got a CH like in an alkane, perhaps we've got a benzene ring which has a different type of CH, perhaps we have a C double bond C, and so on. And because each of these bonds has its own unique set of vibrations, it's possible from an interpretation of the spectrum obtained to elucidate the bonds and then possibly elucidate the actual chemical structure, particularly if we have from mass spectrometry the relative molecular mass of the molecules as well. So the key point, when the energy of a photon passing through a sample matches the energy associated with a particular vibration in one of the bonds present in that sample, that photon of energy is absorbed, and the key thing is the detector picks that up and it registers as a trough on the graph. And we'll see that the graph has on the x-axis a unit for wavelength, perhaps a strange unit, it's known as reciprocal centimeters, or centimeters to the minus one, also known as the wave number. Moving on, here's a simple schematic diagram of how the infrared spectrometer works then. We'll have a sample tube, and we'll get a clear picture of this in a moment, where we have our sample. It may be in a glass cell, if it's a gas. It may be, as you'll see, be coated between two so-called salt plates. The infrared radiation, and this is a simplification here, but it'll get us started. The infrared radiation is passed through the sample, and the detector at the other side is going along like this. Look at me down here at the graph here. It's going along, and suddenly something happens. This is giving a very sort of, what would we call this, a very wide trough here. But sometimes we get sharper troughs. Then it kind of works its way back to normal. The energy here where my pen is at the moment, and this is a particular wavelength, and it'll be marked on the x-axis. This doesn't correspond to any particular vibration within the molecule, but here this does, so down some of the energy gets removed and that's picked up as a trough, and so on back up again. And you can see it goes in the range here from about 600 what are known as reciprocal centimeters up to 4000 reciprocal centimeters. Now when the detector picks that up, if that's connected to some electronic device, that can give us a printout. It can interpret that and present it as a graph. Now here's a more honest, slightly more complicated but important illustration of what actually happens. What we do is we take the infrared source and we pass some of it through a so-called reference cell and some of it through the sample. We'll see, for example, that a solvent is used here on occasions, a solvent called Nujol, N-U-J-O-L, which is actually just paraffin, a long-chain hydrocarbon. And we would put in the sample here, we would put the solvent itself, paraffin or Nujol, and in here we would have the sample perhaps dissolved within Nujol. Now, the important thing about this is, because the detector is getting information from two sources, it's getting it from your sample, and then it's getting it from the reference cell. Both cells have used NuGEL. NuGEL, you'll see, is needed in some cases to actually get your sample into solution so as to be able to coat it on so-called salt bridges. The detector then will be clever enough to be able to subtract what is present in the reference cell and therefore isolate exactly what's happening as a result of bonds within the molecule, and you'll get your display, your graph with its troughs that can be interpreted. Okay, so we've been going for about 15 minutes. All of that has been important. You should have a good, clear understanding of what we've just covered there in terms of vibrations within molecules. Now we're going to take a look at the steps. If you're standing beside an infrared spectrometer and you had a sample of a gas, or a sample that was a gas, or a sample that was a solid, or a sample that was a liquid, what would you actually do? It's not terribly complicated. Some of the key things then. First of all, put on some gloves, because this worked with tiny, tiny amounts of sample. And in the sweat, for example, on your hands, you've got various chemicals, including amino acids. So get the gloves on first. Now down here in this diagram, you can see these little discs. They're about the size of a 1 pound coin, a little bit bigger, a little bit thicker. And they are made out of just a salt, sodium chloride, typically out of sodium chloride. We'll see why in a moment. They could also be made out of potassium bromide or calcium fluoride. But typically they're made out of sodium chloride, and they're called salt plates, simply salt plates. And you notice that they're transparent. And in a moment, they will be stuck together if we look at it sideways on. And right between the two will be a film of your sample, perhaps dissolved or spread out in paraffin, what is known as NuGEL. So you use the salt plates that have been thoroughly cleaned and dried. It's important that these plates are clean and dry. Again, any tiny amounts of any residue from a previous usage will contaminate your sample and give you misleading results. It goes on to say here the sodium chloride is used as it does not absorb strongly in the infrared region, whereas if you use glass, glass does, and that's going to mask what's happening with your sample. Now, one of the problems, however, with sodium chloride is that sodium chloride does, of course, dissolve in water, so you've got to avoid using water as a solvent. You then use a Pasteur pipette, which you can see here, to place a drop of your sample. So if it's a liquid, you just simply put your liquid on there. Let's say you had an organic liquid that happened to be ethanol. This is the way you would do it. You then take the second disc and you set it on top of the first disc and squeeze the two together so that you get a thin film of your sample between the two discs. And you always handle the edges rather than put your fingers on top, obviously. And you then bring it to the spectrometer to move to the next stage. So you've got your Pasteur pipettes here. You've got a little desiccator to keep your salt plates dry. And here's your little salt plate sitting here. This is what it looks like inside the spectrometer, very straightforward. I pick up on white here, I can show you. It says the pair of discs are placed in a V-shaped holder. There's a screw device there, I think it comes down like this, and it goes back up like this. So there's a little, imagine, it's hard to see there, but imagine there's a little V-shaped thing there, and you simply set your discs into that. And now the infrared source, I believe, is going to come from the lower end here. Imagine it going through the discs. There's obviously a hole in this plate here. And it passes on through to the detector. Maybe the other way around, I'm not sure here. But this shows you the way in which the beam travels through the sodium plates and therefore through that very thin film of your sample. And you run your infrared spectrum. What about if you had a solid? What would you have to do differently? This is where we bring in the NuGEL. N-U, see it down here. N-U-J-O-L. The solid, first of all, is ground. We have a tiny little mortar here. And again, a little in the person's hand here, we have a little pestle. And you put just a tiny amount of your sample into the mortar. And then over here, you may just about make out on the bottle, it says, I believe it says liquid paraffin, and that's your new jaw, a long chain or a mixture of long chain hydrocarbons. It's mixed then with a few drops of the liquid paraffin to form a paste. It's not a solution. A thin film of the liquid then, your sample within the paste, is then spread out again on the sodium chloride plates. And once again, the sample is then placed into the machine. And remember about the reference cell. The reference cell is an identical rock salt plate, but instead of having your sample and neugeol, it has the neugeol only. The detector is a key sentence here. The detector then compares the two beams it receives and can remove any peaks. This is quite often used, peaks. I would prefer to call them troughs. It can remove any troughs due to the neugeol or indeed to the plates, should the plates be producing any troughs. And thirdly and finally, if it wasn't a liquid and it wasn't a solid, it was gas, then you have one of these to put your gas in, and you'd have to make sure you evacuate that. You don't want to have any air in there, so you'd probably get a good sample of your a reasonable quantity of your sample to be tested so that you could entirely flush the system out. And once you feel sure that you've got the air flushed out and the glass cell here filled with your sample, you just put this into the spectrometer and proceed as before. This is a group of our students working here at a local university. Student is grinding a solid down and mixing it into a paste with the neugeol solution, or neugeol liquid I should say. Here someone's holding up the, you may just about make that, you can hardly make them out here, but we have at this stage coated a little bit of the paste onto one of the glass discs, press the other glass disc against it, and we've got a film. And this is the way the light then will pass, the infrared light will pass through that. And in the local universities we have infrared spectrometers that are more than 30 years old, but they still work perfectly well. And here you can see the graphical printout that was obtained. And here's the graph going across in, and suddenly it picks up something, comes back up again, and so on. And the person here, Tommy, that I photographed, has been working with these for years and years, and Tommy doesn't need to be looking down here at this scale. He knows right away, second nature to him, to say, all right, he's fit to say, oh, that's caused by a CH and a benzene ring, so this is aromatic. That's an OH, but it's not an alcohol. It's the OH you get in a carboxylic acid, or, well, there's an NH, or, yeah, that's a CHO, that's an aldehyde, and so on. Okay, that's the workings, and here we are. We're in 23 minutes, so we spent about 8 minutes on the workings, and I think that was worthwhile, even though you're not going to be tested in any detail there. Now, number one, you don't have to memorize the wavelengths of these various different vibrations within organic molecules. You will be given the values in the examination. In AQA, it is actually provided as a separate table together with your periodic table. I think in SIA it's provided down at the bottom of the periodic table, but they will be provided. No need to memorize them. A bit like the periodic table, what you have to do is to learn how to use them. Now, we could set about trying to sort of, indeed I attempted to try to sort of simplify these and put them in a hierarchy, starting with the ones with the lowest wave number, going up to the ones with the highest. But the problem is, some of them stretch over quite a range of wave number. Look at this one, for example. So you're having to code a value of here, something like 2,600 up to 3,500. And it's not easy to put those down. You could try to take a midpoint, but that's not terribly useful either, because then if you're taking only midpoints, you'll find that some of the vibrations in different molecules for different bonds are occurring at the same number. So I'm afraid there's no real way in which we can simplify this. And given that you don't have to memorize it, just use it, I really don't think there's any point in proceeding much beyond that. But as you go through the next number of samples, and indeed through the second snapcast of past paper questions, do attempt to begin to build up a small memory bank of the key vibrations, whether it be CHs in an aliphatic chain, or a CH in an aromatic ring, or an OH in an alcohol versus an OH in a carboxylic acid. See what you can do by way of trying to build up a little bit of memory regarding these bonds. But the bottom line is, you will always be given a table. The smallest value here is way down at, remember, it's going roughly, the graph starts over here typically at 600, runs way up to 4000. So the one with the smallest wave number is the, it would seem to be the CC bond, as far as the bonds presented here are concerned. At the other end of the scale are the OH of an alcohol. The OH, you notice, present in an acid, is occurring at a lower wave number. But what we do is, we, as you'll see in the following samples, we take a look at where the trough is, and then we simply go and look at the table and see, well, what does that match up with? And different examining boards give a different presentation. Here's another presentation from a different source, telling us that a CH is at that, and indeed, it's really complicated, telling us, well, this is due to scissoring or whatever, and that's way beyond what we need to know. You'd need to be a postgraduate chemist to be interested and able to use those kinds of things. Okay, one other thing before we begin to look at specific chemicals. There is a part of the electromagnetic spectrum which ranges from 600 to 1450 wave numbers, and it's known as the fingerprint region. It gives a very complex set of troughs. You might have difficulty, especially if you haven't used it very often, being able to quickly analyze what a particular, and it looks like a fingerprint. We're going to get a lot happening down here in that particular part of the electromagnetic spectrum. Up here it's going to be more simpler. We may get, you know, something like this. But this part from 1450 down to 600, it's known as the fingerprint region of the infrared spectrum. And while we're not going to get much individual bits of information out from that, remember that if you connect this data into a computer, and the computer has been fed in data from pure samples, in other words, you put a sample, a known pure sample, into the mass spectrum, and then you send that spectrum off to a computer to save it in its data bank, and it saves it with a particular name, you won't be surprised that if we put in an unknown sample and we get the spectrum and we send that data to the computer, we can get the computer to interrogate that. In simple terms, we ask the computer, in your data bank, do you have a graph that looks exactly or very close to this? And the computer will come back and say, 98% possibility that it is CH3, CHO, or whatever. Or maybe 98% sure that it's an aldehyde. Or it may be able to elucidate even further, because perhaps ethanol and propanol, two members of the same family, give a different fingerprint in here. And while it would be difficult for us maybe to distinguish between the two, given that they're complex and the same relatively similar, the computer would have no difficulty picking up on the subtleties there. So the fingerprint region, very, very useful. And we'll see an illustration of where it's particularly useful for distinguishing between two isomers, for example, two structure or two position isomers. I think the example we'll be looking at is distinguishing between propan-1-ol and propan-2-ol. As far as they're concerned, they'll be identical, more or less, in here. And here there will be subtle differences between the two that a computer would have no difficulty distinguishing between. Moving on. So here's the fingerprint region you see here. I've just shade it a little bit for you. This one's a relatively simple graph within that part, but some were highly complicated with lots of complex looking troughs within it. The bands for CH bends appeared at approximately 1,000. Remember, we're not just talking about one CH vibration, there will be bends, stretches and various, so do bear that in mind. And apparently CH bends take place at around 1,000, which is in here somewhere presumably, given that it goes from around 1,400 or so down to 600. And what it's saying here is when it comes to benzene, benzene is a particularly symmetrical molecule, and as a result of that, there's not a lot by way of troughs showing up on the infrared spectrum. There's a big difference between an aliphatic organic chemical and an aromatic organic chemical. And one should be able to, one of the first things that one tries to do as an organic chemist is to classify it as aliphatic or aromatic. And anyone working regularly with infrared spectroscopy will be able to spot a mile off when the spectrum comes out by glancing at the fingerprint region if you have an aromatic, because it'll show up the troughs at these particular positions. And if they are not there, then you know it's aliphatic. Here's an example where we're using the fingerprint region to distinguish between two molecules that are only subtly different. This has the OH on the first carbon of the three carbons. This has it on the middle or second carbon. They look very similar in this part of the spectrum, but if we look at this, probably a trained eye would be able to pick this up, but certainly the computer will have no difficulty telling you from a database if it's already been fed in pure propanol and told it's pure propanol, and fed in pure propan-2-ol and told it's propan-2-ol, and you feed in your sample and you're not sure which it is, the computer will be able to come back and tell you, yes, it's propan-2-ol or whatever. I've just played around with this. I superimposed the two together just more or less to show you they're very similar in this area, and they're even fairly similar here, but there's enough difference in the fingerprint region for these two position isomers to be able to say which is which. Now let's pick up. Each of these picks up on a particular bond, and there's something missing here that you will always have, and that is you will always have this table here. So try to pick up on, this is cyclobutanol. So bute, it means there's four carbons in a row, and butanol, it's got this arrangement here presumably, so it's got an OH, butanol. Try to find out where you think an OH should show up, and it's an OH of an alcohol, albeit a cyclic alcohol. So if it was an OH of an acid, it's appearing below 3000. If it's an OH of an alcohol, it's appearing above, well above 3000. Going to the wrong one. Okay, can you see where that's coming up? Well, you're seeing here a fairly broad trough here, and that's the OH there. That's where you're expecting it to show up, you can see, in that region. I hope that's confirmed by what you're seeing here. But remember, there isn't just one type of OH vibration. There's stretches, scissoring, and so forth. So you may, some of these others over here may be associated with some other type of OH event. But of key importance, and this is really the level that we're at, we're looking for the existence of an OH. Talks about sp3 here, disregard that please. All I want you to get from this spectrum, this infrared spectrum, is an agreement that it was possible to pick up on the OH from the data and looking at the graph. Let's try another one. This is butan-2-ol, and butan-2-ol has got a carbonyl group. Where do you expect to see a carbonyl group show up? And then look over here to see if you can spot it. Just above 1680 there, okay. And it's telling us what these others are here. This is where, if you were feeding this into a database, the computer can give you back so much information as to what it would appear to be. So hopefully you picked up on the on that 1680 to 1750, and this was very, very much where this particular trough appeared. Here's another one. This has got two functional groups. It's got that C double bond C, but it's also got a COC, which is an ether type linkage. Can you see any evidence, any information in this table that might be helpful to you? I've got a CO there, but not a COC, I'm afraid, so we'll have to rely on the graph itself for that. But can you see a C double bond C where it should show up? Did you pick up on that, the C double bond C occurring in and around the mid-1600s? Does that agree? Yeah. Now you may say, but hold on a second, look at that C double bond O. That's not too far away, and you're right, it's true. But it's occurring from 1680 up to 1750. I'm in the right one here, I'll just check, sorry. Yeah, we were in the right one. This here. Hopefully you would agree that that's somewhat lower than the other peak for C double bond O. Let's try another one. Propene 1-all. So this has got the C double bond C. It's also got a COH. So if you look at the table, what are we looking for? We're looking for the alkene. We're looking for the OH of an alcohol. We're looking for something in around the mid-1600s for the C double bond C. We're looking something in around the 3300, 3400, that sort of area. Let's see if we're picking that up. There's the C double bond C where we expected, the mid-1600s. And what about the OH of the alcohol? Yeah, showing up there as well. And again, this is too complex, but the computer would pick up on that very easily. There are other subtleties here which are beyond the remit of our syllabus. I did not get these from past papers. Here's another one, 2-methylpropanol. So we have a C double bond OH and then an aliphatic chain. So we're looking here for the C double bond O of an aldehyde. And here's the carbonyl vibration at 1733, it says. Now these the values and tables from different sources can vary slightly. And this it is occurring in that range, the carbonyl in around the 1700s, which is what it's identifying here. There are other subtleties being picked up here, but all that you need to be able to establish from this is the carbonyl group in this particular spectrum. Let's go and look at some simpler infrared spectra. And here I'll stop and let you have a go at them before we look at the answer. What functional group is showing up there? And I'll give you a table. So take a moment there and try to establish where that trough is occurring. This is 3000, that's 2000. So each of these is 200. So where's this peak occurring? What would you reckon? Here's your table. And here's the answer coming up. Did you get the OH? It's occurring here. The OH of an alcohol. Way up around the 3550. Hopefully you agree with that. You may say, well, it looks a wee bit higher than in wave number, but close enough, I hope. What about this one? What do you reckon is causing this one at 3000, and you have to take note of the fact that it's methane. Not much choice there, is there? Has to be a CH, but what type of CH vibration is it? A stretch? A bend? Scissoring? Well, that's going beyond what we need to know. There's your CH, occurs around about the 3000 mark, doesn't it? That's what we're getting there. So it's a CH. We don't have to say it's a CH stretch or bend, we just simply say it's a CH. We use the generic term vibration. Okay. I'm afraid I'd lost the... there it is. I thought I'd lost it. Have a go at that one. Have I jumped the answer? Let's see. Perhaps I have. Sorry about that. What functional group is identified by these troughs? This is a pretty difficult one. It's very broad. Now, we'd need the numbers, and I'm afraid the numbers are missing there. Sometimes the numbers don't come out. I can tell you that this is 3,000 here. That's 3,500. I can tell you that to the right of this trough is 1,500, and this is 2,000. Any idea? Just note what you think the wave numbers of those two troughs are, please. What would you write down for those? I'm going to show you the table in a moment. Here's the table. Match up your wave numbers there for me, please. And did you get this? This is the CO. We've come across that a few times now, haven't we? And this O stretch is very broad. Okay. And that completes our look at this, I believe. If we put together those two bonds, an OH stretch, and it seems that would be an OH stretch. I didn't pick up on that, but presumably that was an OH stretch identified for a carboxylic acid rather than an OH for an alcohol. And we saw we had a C double bond O. And you see how if you find out the bonds that are present, you can begin to elucidate something of the structure, given that a carboxyl group has both the C double bond O and the OH. Had we found a C double bond O and an absence of an OH, then we'd been thinking of a carbonyl, an aldehyde or a ketone perhaps. Thanks for listening, and do please consider taking a look at the accompanying Snapcast looking at past paper questions from SIA, AQA and OCR.